We are very excited tonight to have Dr. Grant with us. He's an orthopedic surgeon with Duke Med in Knightdale. His office is there in Knightdale. He's had experience with the Baltimore Ravens, the Washington Nationals, some other professional sporting teams. He's going to talk to us tonight about arm care, prevention of injuries, maybe some pitch counts. And what we thought we'd do is go about 30, 45 minutes with just his presentation. If you have a question along the way, please feel free to stop and ask him as he goes through the presentation. And then after that, we'll take a little break. Then we'll come back and maybe open it up to all your questions. Anything that you've got, pre-game, post-game, pitch counts, anything that you might have concern about that Dr. Grant would be glad to answer. So thank you for coming again, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Grant. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Thanks for having us. Good evening, everybody. I'm Andre Grant, as the slide says. Thanks for the introduction. I've been in the area for about 3 years. I'm an orthopedic surgeon. I specialize in sports medicine, which all that means is I went to medical school, and then one day I graduated, and then I spent the next 5 years learning how to operate and take care of patients. And then I do a year after all that, specializing in the care of athletes and specific sports injuries. During that year, I listed a couple of teams up there. I was with the Ravens and the Nationals, but a lot of the colleges in Baltimore, D.C. area, Loyola, you know, Hopkins, Goucher College, Morgan State, as well as some semi-pro teams in the area. So I've gotten a bunch of experience in dealing with even the high school, collegiate, you know, the semi-pro and the pro athletes. So I'm able to bring that experience here now into the East Wake area, and I'm really happy to be here. So tonight we're going to talk a little bit about baseball-related injuries, but I sort of want to touch on a lot of different injuries. You know, you can see, and you do see a lot of the shoulder and the elbow injuries, but I'm going to go from the head all the way down. So, but concentrate more on the shoulder and elbow, because that's the more common thing that you see, especially with a throwing athlete. But again, I'm going to concentrate on those injuries, but I'm going to try to hit a whole bunch of things. So I hope it's not too boring for you. And if you have questions, just stop me right in whenever you have them, and raise your hand, and hopefully we can figure things out. So a little bit about what I just said. We're going to talk a little bit about the epidemiology. What kind of injuries are we seeing in the youth athlete, and in particular, the baseball player? We'll talk a little bit about that. But one of the key notes that I want to talk about first, or point out first, is the child athlete is not the same as the adult or the skeletally mature athlete. You'll hear me say that a lot during this talk, skeletally mature. What that means is they may not be mentally mature, okay, but their bones, that is the youth athlete, their bones will be have reached, I should say, their end of growth, okay? And that makes a difference when it comes to sports and injuries. And that really makes the difference between the adolescent athlete and the adult athlete. We'll talk about specific sports injuries. Like I said, we'll go from head to toe. And we'll talk about management and prevention and have a discussion, if we can, about certain things that you've seen or any questions you may have. So, why are sports important? You know, sports are very important. I started playing sports when I was about 3-4 years old, and I played through college. I was more a football player, but, you know, I played baseball, soccer. I think every kid where I grew up played some soccer. It was the birthright, if you will, the rite of passage. You had to play some soccer. Lacrosse, you know, t-ball, the whole nine yards. But why is it important to get kids out there and playing sports? You know, personally, my thoughts are that they teach lessons that we can't teach our children by example in everyday life. It's a unique situation, to be a part of a team. And you learn a lot of relationship skills, teamwork skills, you know, things you don't learn in the classroom. So I really encourage sports. But I encourage sports when sports are safe, okay? And so that's where things are that we're going to talk about today come into play. It's important to play sports, but it's important to play them in the safe manner. And to listen to the kids, you know, complaints. Listen to or tell the kids to listen to their own bodies. Let their coaches, their trainers, their parents know when they're having pain, because that is the key to getting the injury assessed, diagnosed, treated, and recovered from, so they can get back out there and participate in the stuff that they love. So a couple of numbers here, just the shock and awe part of the talk. There are almost 3 million emergency room visits a year by kids being injured in some sort of sporting activity. Now, under the age of 10, we're talking more of the recreational sport, all right? The bike riding, the you know, roller skating, the skateboarding, you know, the X Games are big now. And so even my kids, they're 6 and 5. They want to, you know, do flips off of dirt ramps and all that stuff in the backyard. Well, you know, that's sport. It's a very dangerous sport, but it's sport nonetheless. And so we see a lot of injuries every year from kids from the ages of 3, 4, 5 up to 16, 17, 18. And so, you know, a couple numbers there, 1.5 million BMX bike injuries, almost 3 million skateboarding injuries. I haven't skateboarded since the early 80s. I didn't know people are still doing that, but they are. Inline skating, and the big one down at the bottom that we never had as kids were trampolines. Nowadays, my kids go for a play date at their friend's house. They've got a trampoline in the backyard. They never had those when I was a kid, but they've got them now, and they certainly can cause problems. So it's important to be aware of all those things that could happen. And again, play safe. High school sports are probably the most common age level, or I should say high school athletes are the most common age level to get injured. Now, you're talking about bigger, stronger, faster kids, okay? That's when the big hits start coming in football and other contact sports. And so that's when you see a whole lot more injuries. All right? I've listed football there for boys, cross country, and soccer for girls, basketball as you see in the picture there, but that's where you really start to see a whole bunch of more serious injuries. And so right before that level, though, the early teenage years is when things start to pick up a little bit. And so we'll concentrate more on those folks. Again, kids are not little adults, so we have to treat them differently. Okay, I see kids, kid athletes come into the clinic and see me for different things. And I can see a minute later an adult athlete with the same injury. There's two different treatments there. And so it's important to recognize that, and we'll talk a little bit more specifically as we go forward. Bottom line there, children's bones are less brittle than adults. So that's why they don't break like adults do, which is a good thing. They bend, but it's still something that you have to recognize as a healthcare professional as myself, but the coaches need to recognize that, parents need to know when is it that I need to say, hey, my kid needs to see their pediatrician or have to go to the emergency room or see an orthopedic surgeon. If we have time, we'll talk about concussions. I mean, baseball is really a contact sport, but not a collision sport, okay? Concussions are a lot more common in the high-impact sports like football, but you can see them, you know? Hit balls being, you know, our heads being hit by balls, though there's a helmet there. Concussions I do see in baseball, less common, but you still see them. So if we have time, we'll touch a little bit on the kids and concussions. So let's talk about a few sports-related injuries. So, why are kids not adults? Okay, The number one reason is the growth play. Okay, we talked a little bit about their bones growing. They're maturing. Kids are getting, you know, they're getting their growth spurt. Boys typically get their growth spurt around the age of 13, 14. Girls more, a little earlier, so, maybe 10, 11 years of age. And the reason why they grow or get longer is because of the growth plate. Every bone essentially has a growth plate. It's an area of cartilage, okay, which is the soft part of bone that contributes to the length. The cells in the growth plate multiply, and then they calcify to become bone. And as they multiply, that creates the length in the bone. Well, that area is not as tough as bone, okay? So that's the inherent weak spot in kids' bones. So I see, on a weekly basis, I may see 10 to 15 children who have fallen, and their x-ray looks like this. There's no fracture there. There's no broken bone there, but they have a growth plate, and they hurt there. And so as the healthcare professional, I have to say, well, this is probably an injury to their growth plate, which in and of itself can be a problem, but going forward, if it's not recognized, would lead to other problems. Namely, you know, if this growth plate stops growing before its scheduled time, you're talking about deformities, okay? Angular deformities, shorter deformities. Johnny's leg is shorter than the other leg. Well, that's a problem. So we have to recognize these things early and get them treatment early. Apophyses are similar to growth plates. Instead of creating or contributing to the length of the bone, they contribute to the circumference of the bone, okay? Who here has ever heard of Osgood Schlatter's disease? No one. That's funny, because when I was going to school, it seemed like every other boy on my football team had Osgood Schlatter's disease. Essentially, what that is inflammation of this apophysis or this growth plate right underneath the kneecap, okay? It comes from overuse, running, jumping, all the things that you do playing sports. But, you know, as kids, that's what we want to do. We want to play sports. And so if you overdo it, what happens is this apophysis gets inflamed, okay? It gets inflamed, and what that brings is pain, swelling, inability to run, jump, twist, cut, turn, and so it decreased playtime, okay? And so, again, one of the most common reasons that I have kids coming into my clinic, yet they're coming, and we're recognizing that this can be a problem. So when your son, daughter says, you know, every time I play basketball, every time I run the bases, I feel pain right here, you know, pay attention to them. It's not just the growing pains, okay? It might be something sort of like this. And if we treat it early, you recover early and you get back out onto the field. So along with the apophysis, you get different, there are different apophyses, if you will, all over the body. These are the most common ones. Sievers disease, that's an inflammation of the apophysis on the heel, okay? So heel pain is the chief complaint with athletic activity. Osgood Schlatter's there. Age 11 to 15, I see it most commonly. That's pain in front of the knee. Okay. The Sindig Larsson Johansson, very rare, but again, a common cause for actual knee pain. So something that you can see and diagnose from an exam as well as an x-ray. And then we'll touch on Little Leaguer's elbow in a minute. And this is this Osgood Schlatter's disease. You can see this is the growth plate here, okay? You've got one at the end of the thigh bone and at the top of the leg bone. But here you have this apophysis that your kneecap attaches to, and this is a bit swollen and it's lifting off the bone a little bit. And so that's the x-ray that I see with this Osgood Schlatter's disease. Ankle sprains. There's a lot of controversy when it comes to ankle sprains in children. That is, if I see an adult who said, I twisted my ankle over playing, you know, turning around second base, heading for third, and I turn my ankle in. X-ray is negative for a fracture. That is 9 times out of 10, if not 99 times out of 100, an ankle sprain. All that means is you've stretched the ligaments on the ankle, okay? But with a child that's skeletally immature, they've got growth plates that are involved around the ankle, okay? I can't easily say that that's an ankle sprain. That could very well be an injury to that growth plate. So again, ankle sprains in children are different than ankle sprains in adults. If you have a kid who has sprained their ankle and they continue to have pain, it's probably time for them to see either their primary care physician or an orthopedic surgeon to get evaluated, because that can end up, if not treated the right way, can end up being a problem. High ankle sprains, again, it's just it's a different rotation of the ankle. It's a twisting of another ligament, but again, something that needs to be heard, recognized, and hopefully seen by someone in the healthcare field. The ACL, going forward, the ACL, again, kids can get ACL injuries. They're less common than they are for a skeletally mature athlete. But the ACL is the main ligament that keeps the knee stable, okay? It's the central ligament, if you will. I'm sure you guys, if anyone watches SportsCenter, they've heard of the ACL. Stands for the anterior cruciate ligament. Again, it's the main stabilizer of the knee. Children can get ACL injuries too. They're a different kind of injury. Again, you know, sliding into home, turning or twisting their knee, feeling a pop in the knee. In a skeletally immature patient, that can certainly be a fracture or an avulsion injury. That is, this ligament attaches to bone, but that bone is weak in comparison to the ligament, so the bone may snatch a piece, or the ligament may snatch a piece of bone right off. All right, it won't tear like adults get. It will avulse itself off the bone, essentially ripping itself off the bone with a little piece of bone with it. So again, kids skeletally immature can get this injury. Some may need surgery. In my opinion, most need surgery. There's a controversy with that as well. Kids needing ACL surgery, how old they need to be mature enough for the surgery, and what kind of surgery you do. I think if Johnny doesn't have an ACL, Johnny doesn't play sports, okay? And it's hard to really, for me, to tell a 10-year-old that they need to sit out of sports until they're grown, because that's not going to happen. So I'm on the other side of the fence, in that I think, you know, kids and ACLs, they definitely need surgery. And it's a different type of surgery, but they certainly should have their ligament addressed. Hamstrings, again, very common for running athletes. Again, baseball fits into that, but track, football. And these can be notorious for being those chronic injuries that never get any better, because it doesn't have a lot of cachet like an ACL does. Hamstring, you know, you get a little massage, ice it down, and it'll get better. Well, it's that very reason that they never get better, or they become a chronic problem. You know, I see kids a lot. They finally come to me after it's been a couple months that they've been dealing with a hamstring injury, because it was never really treated well enough in the first place. And so now it's a chronic injury. Now we're behind the ball and we're trying to catch up, getting this thing to heal so they can go back out and play their sport without any significant issue. So again, just listening and knowing, being aware, ultimately aware of your kids and their health, is the key to getting things diagnosed and treated the right way. All right, finally, the meat of what we're going to talk about today, the upper extremity injuries. Now, with baseball, upper extremity injuries are probably the most common thing I see. And they could either be chronic, overuse types of things, or can be acute things. You know, fractures fit into this category. You know, again, home plate collision, sliding into second base. I've seen all these scenarios where there is an acute event, okay? a collision at home plate, and ankles turned, or, you know, someone's cleat goes directly into their shin, okay? Fractures can happen from baseball, okay? I see it all the time. And so, yes, you can have your acute injury, but more commonly you have the overuse injury. Nowadays, we've got kids playing baseball all year round, okay? And so they're throwing, they're hitting, they're running, and there's really not a whole lot of time for rest. And so that's when we've noticed we're starting to get into trouble, okay? There's been a lot of medical research on upper extremity injuries in children recently, over the last, I would say, 10 years, if not less than that. And that's really sort of trying to identify what we need to do better to try to get these athletes or prevent them from getting injured. But once they're injured, how do we heal them and get them back out on the field? And so Little Leaguer's shoulder, I don't know if anyone's ever heard of that, but it's an overuse injury, okay? Probably one of the more common shoulder problems I see in your guys' age group, all right? What are we talking about? Well, it goes back to the growth plate, okay? The shoulder has a growth plate as well, okay? And it doesn't close until later on in teenage life. And so that growth plate is contributing to the length of the arm. So it's the inherent weakness in the shoulder. And so you've got kids pitching, throwing, you know, day in, day out. You know, they get some rest, but, you know, they're really playing ball all year round, different leagues, and they really don't get a whole lot of rest from throwing. And so that growth plate on the top of the shoulder gets stressed out, okay, and that becomes painful. Some of the symptoms or things that I hear when I see these kids in the clinic, pain during and after throwing in the shoulder, okay? A decrease in velocity and control if they're a pitcher, all right? They have difficulty warming up. They say, my shoulder's sore. I can't really warm up. And their shoulder's painful, okay? They get home from the game and they can't even have the arm hanging. They have to support it. You know, they can't lay on that side that night. You know, you give them some Advil or whatever your non-steroidal pain medication of choice is, and, you know, the next day they feel a little bit better, but it's still sore, okay? We're talking about Little Leaguer's shoulder. And again, it's the inflammation of that growth plate. It's not a fracture through it, but it's a stress injury to the growth area of that shoulder. So, and you'll find that this is a common trend of all these things I'm going to talk about tonight. But we really need to rest that shoulder, okay? And you see there at the very bottom, it's a long time that we need to rest it. 2 to 3 months with no throwing whatsoever. And honestly, I usually tell kids, if they've got this, I've diagnosed it in the clinic, we're treating it, and they get better. And they're a pitcher, I say, look, you probably want to consider another position, okay? Because this is a harbinger for something worse in your shoulder if you keep throwing the way you are. So it's really sort of an education that I have to have with the child's parents at that point to say, we need to change something. Okay, I know that he wants or she wants to continue to play, but we have to be careful now that there's a history of this injury in the shoulder because it's susceptible. It can. It can, and I'm gonna touch on that a little bit later on, but it certainly can be preventable. Okay, we're gonna talk about a couple of different things here. Good question. So, exactly, 2 to 3 months, stone cold rest, no throwing a baseball, not even throwing their little brother around the house. We're talking stone cold rest, and then if they so choose to continue on, an interval throwing program going forward, And the throwing program is a long time as well. All right. And so if they get pain in any phase of that program, we go back to square one, not the 2 to 3 months rest, but we go back to the beginning of that program, because we want to make sure we go slow enough that that shoulder is healthy by the time they're strong enough to get back out on the field. Rotator cuff tendonitis and impingement. What is that? Well, the shoulder is a ball and socket joint, okay? And it's very unstable, okay? That's why we can rotate our shoulders 360 degrees, because it's unstable. It's inherently so. And so there are different things around the shoulder that keep it in place, okay? There are ligaments, okay? Tendons, all right? And one of the dynamic stabilizers of the shoulder, basically the muscles that keep that shoulder in its socket when you throw, is the rotator cuff. Okay, it's a group of four muscles that envelop the shoulder, the ball and socket, and keep it stable. Okay, overuse of that rotator cuff will cause a problem. Okay, that first line there, it results from a cumulative tensile overload. So whenever you throw, that is tension on the rotator cuff. So again, it leads back to the overuse in the throwing, the constant throwing, the pitching, most importantly. And so increased or cumulative throwing and stress on that rotator cuff can cause it to become inflamed. Now, I have never seen a tear of a rotator cuff in a preteen or a teenager. Never seen it. It can happen. It's very rare, but it can happen. I'm sure the adults may have heard, have a friend, know somebody that's had a rotator cuff tear. I would tell you that if you are a baseball player and you have a rotator cuff tear, you're probably not going to play very much baseball after that, okay? So we don't want to get to that level, okay? That's probably the death knell if you have a rotator cuff tear, because throwers don't really come back to the same level of performance after you've had to have your shoulder operated on. And if you have a rotator cuff tear, you need surgery to have that repaired. So we don't want it to get to that level, okay? So we have tendonitis, which means an inflammatory process of that rotator cuff tendon. An impingement, really won't get much into it, but essentially what can happen is the mechanics can be off in the throwing shoulder, and that will lead to that rotator cuff bumping into other things in the shoulder, okay? Most notably the bone, the bony structure on the outside of the shoulder comes into play, okay? Especially if it's swollen, so it's a vicious cycle, okay? That rotator cuff gets swollen, there's less room for it in the shoulder vault or within those bones, and so whenever they come over the top, the bone gets in the way, keeps pinching at that rotator cuff. Vicious cycle, pinching, gets swollen, it's swollen, not enough room, it pinches. And so we have to diagnose it early and get it fixed. And what do we do? Well, again, initial treatment, rest, anti-inflammatory, that's that NSAIDs, anti-inflammatories like Advil, Motrin, Children's Motrin, okay, ice, and, you know, shutting it down, completely shutting it down from throwing, okay? And that's to get that shoulder better so we can start the interval throwing program, get that athlete back out onto the mound. Physical therapy, strengthen that shoulder up, okay, so we don't get back into this situation. Stretching is key, okay, and we'll talk about that a little bit more later, but stretching is key, especially before the outing and afterwards. And then sometimes, it is rare, but sometimes if you have a tear, it will need surgery. Instability. Has anyone heard of the labrum? You may have heard on SportsCenter, someone's got a torn labrum. Dwight Howard for the Lakers has a torn labrum in his shoulder. What is that thing? Well, again, shoulder is inherently unstable. And so, again, one of the mechanisms of keeping that shoulder in its socket is the labrum, okay? The ball and socket, the reason why it's so unstable is the ball and socket's almost akin to a golf ball sitting on a golf tee, okay? How many of you guys play golf? Somebody. All right. So you've put a golf ball on a golf tee. It wants to roll off. You have to center that thing just perfectly to keep it there. Now you get used to it, but you first try to do it, and it's kind of difficult. That's because the ball is significantly larger than the tee. That's exactly what the shoulder looks like, okay? The ball of the shoulder is 3 times the size of the socket. And so it always wants to roll off that tee or the socket. And so the body has different mechanisms to keep that ball in its socket, okay? And one of which is the labrum. What is that? Well, if you took that golf tee and you added a sort of a gasket on the rim of that golf tee, what's going to happen? You're going to build the concavity of the golf tee, and it's going to wrap around that ball, keeping it stable, okay? And that's what the labrum does. And so you can get injuries of the labrum. Again, relatively rare for the adolescent athlete, but can still happen. And it comes from microtrauma, repetitive activity. Again, throwing time and time again. What happens is when you throw, you go from cocking to acceleration. That ball rotates within the shoulder joint, okay? Now, it's not a perfect circle. It's sort of oblong and odd-shaped. And so when it rolls forward, it rolls against those ligaments. And over again, you can get micro tears of the ligament, and they'll stretch out like an old T-shirt, okay? You wear it enough, all of a sudden it gets huge, okay? Because it's just been stretched over and over and over again. That neck to that T-shirt gets stretched over and over and over again, just like the ligaments in the shoulder. And so the ligaments don't keep that shoulder in its place very well. And so you start getting a sloppy shoulder on the inside, okay? And that can cause problems. If it's not working the way it's supposed to work, there's collateral damage. The labrum gets torn, the ligaments start stretching even more. You can get injuries of the rotator cuff as well if there is, you know, this shoulder is moving around too much, okay? One of the, probably the most common things I will see in a pitcher, namely, but it could be a quarterback, any sort of thrower, is what we call glenohumeral internal rotation deficit, okay? If you walk around a major league clubhouse, grab all the pitchers and ask them to do this and do this, okay? What you're going to find is their non-throwing shoulder maybe goes to here and here, okay? Their throwing shoulder, I mean, they can scratch their behind with how far they can go back, and they'll come to about here. So they'll be like this, okay? So they've lost, and this is an adaptation thing, but they've lost the internal, as we call it, rotation of their shoulder. And that's because they don't need it, okay? They need that cocking, okay, that what we call external rotation this way, okay, to develop the speed, okay? And so they don't need the follow-through to be normal. But that balance can be shifted. That's okay as long as this to here is equal to this to here, okay? That needs to be balanced. If that is out of balance, okay, that's when you start getting problems with the shoulder, such as this instability. So a stretching program is key to keep that balance between the non-throwing shoulder and the throwing shoulder. So what can you get? Like I said, you can get rotator cuff tears. Most commonly I hear my arm feels dead. Again, lack of velocity, trouble loosening up before a start. MRI is probably very useful, or probably the most useful thing in this situation to diagnose these things. It's hard to diagnose these clinically, although it's possible, but I use MRI or an arthrogram, so MRI with some contrast in it, really to solidify my diagnosis and get and figure out what we're going to do. Okay. Again, treatment is rest, ice, anti-inflammatory medicines, physical therapy, then a throwing program thereafter. If things have not gotten better, 4 to 6 months down the road, you almost have to bite the bullet and say, hey, we need to do something to help this shoulder. And that's, we wait a long time, but if after that they're still having a problem, that's when we go with surgery, okay? And surgery is basically, if there are loose ligaments, we tighten them. If there's torn cartilage, we fix it, okay? If there's torn rotator cuff tendons, we repair those as well. And so it's dependent on, upon what's going on in the shoulder, and that guides the treatment. But again, it's really non-operative treatment until it fails. So anyone have any questions on the shoulder stuff we just talked about? Okay. With the shoulder comes the elbow as well. We need, the elbow is very important in throwing, okay? And so I see just as many elbow problems as I do shoulder problems with baseball players. And the reason why, again, we need our elbow to generate that force, okay? And most commonly, it's the inside of the elbow, okay? You may have heard of Tommy John, okay? He's probably the most famous pitcher to have this sort of elbow injury, okay? But he had this when he was an adult. The kid's counterpart to that, or the equivalent of the kid's throwing elbow, or the adult throwing elbow, is this kid's little leaguer's elbow, okay? Essentially, what's going on is, again, you're having repetitive, we call it valgus load at the elbow. So what happens? You're externally rotated, okay? Your forearm is going backward, your humerus or your arm is going forward. You have a valgus or a bending force at the elbow. And the apex of that bending force is right here on the inside, okay? There are ligaments on the inside of the elbow, very important ligaments that keep it from doing that. But over time, you can get micro injury or micro trauma to that ligament, okay? And that's when you run into a problem. This is, there's also a growth plate in that area, okay? So if it's not the ligament that's the problem, it's this growth plate, okay? Just like we talked about earlier, that growth plate over time, if you keep stressing it out, it will get inflamed and it become painful. Painful during and after throwing, okay? It gets inflamed every time that throw, it doesn't even have to be a pitcher. I've seen this in catchers as well. Besides the pitcher, the catcher throws the most times, you know, during a game, okay? And so they're susceptible to this as well. The key is rest, okay? If we rest it, we heal it, and we strengthen it, the good news is it probably won't come back, okay? But it's really important to recognize it early, because the longer it goes on, the harder it is to recover from, okay? So we really need to pay attention and get to it early. Usually, again, treatment is rest, ice, strengthening. Not as long as the little leaguer's shoulder, okay? It's only about 2 to 4 weeks here, on average. Maybe sometimes I keep kids out about 6, 8 weeks. I'm waiting for them not only to get for their x-rays to be normal, but if they have no longer have any tenderness on their elbow, and their x-rays look good, then we start them into their throwing program slowly to get them back out on the field. This is that Tommy John ligament that we talked about a little bit earlier, the ulnar collateral ligament. Again, it's just one of the ligaments in the elbow that keep it stable. You can have an acute traumatic tear, which I think is probably the acute on chronic situation, meaning that ligament is stressed out and it has micro trauma and finally critically fails on one pitch. But before that, you can have this micro injury or micro trauma to the ligament, exacerbated by late cocking, early acceleration, okay? That's the moment where we've studied this, the angular velocity, if you will. So if you think about a car tire spinning, that speed is what we call in physics angular velocity. Same situation is going on in the throwing arm, okay, at the elbow. And it's extremely fast and the force is extremely high. it exceeds the threshold of that ligament every time you throw. The ligament doesn't tear every time you throw, but it exceeds that limit. So if you keep exceeding that limit over and over and over and over again, you're going to have an injury. And so, important to recognize in the treatment, bracing, okay, physical therapy until things are healed, interval throwing program, getting them back out on the mound. OCDs. This may not come up, or this you may not have heard of this, but an OCD or an osteochondritis desiccans, all that means is you're having inflammation of the bone in the elbow, okay? This is actually on the outside now, we're talking about, the outside of the elbow, okay? And we think it's from compression force in the elbow, again, with the throwing. What happens is one of the bones in the elbow, called the capitellar bone, or the capitellum, gets compressed over and over and over and over again with the throwing motion, and it starts to get inflamed and can die away. In its worst phase, it gets brittle and starts to crack and break. Okay, very common reason for elbow pain in a thrower in the teenage years. Again, opposite side of the elbow, the outside of the elbow. Now we're talking about. Okay, most of the time kids come to me. I get an X-ray first, but MRI is probably the most common thing because I need to stage what's going on here. Because if it's a late stage, it may need something earlier surgically than the early stages do. So I'd like to get the kids in, get them examined, get their MRI going, and then see what, if anything, we need to do. All right. Rest, 6 to 12 months getting back out onto the mound after this. Okay, so it's significant injury, so we want to make sure we identify it early. The back of the elbow can have problems as well. What do you have back there? Well, it's mainly bone, not a whole lot of ligaments back there. You have the triceps tendon that attaches to the bone, okay? Very active in the throwing process. Repetitive contraction of that triceps pulls on the bone, okay? You can imagine, it's just yanking on the bone. Every time you snap, yanking on the bone. And so you can actually get stress fractures of the back of that elbow there. Everybody, you can feel that pointed part of their elbow. That's called the olecranon process. That is the bone that triceps muscle, that horseshoe-shaped muscle in the back, attaches to, okay? And every time you follow through, it contracts and it pulls on that pointed part of your elbow. Well, in kids, that's a soft part of the elbow, okay? And it has a growth plate, and so that can get inflamed. I have seen fractures from this in kids, okay? That usually needs surgery. There's isolated situations where if the bone is not displaced or moved away from its normal position, it can be treated without surgery. But most commonly, that needs to be repaired, okay? And that happens from, you know, throwing over and over again, and then it just takes one throw and pow, okay? And that bone can snap off. So again, can be a chronic situation as well as an acute one, but we need to treat it. All right, here comes the controversy. And so a little bit of this is research data. A little bit is my own personal opinion. So we can fight about it, and I won't get... my feelings won't be hurt, but there's certainly a controversy when it comes to pitching in the skeletally immature athlete, okay? There have been a couple studies that pointed to different types of pitching, okay? Different types of pitches, whether it be a slider or a curveball, some sort of breaking pitch that is detrimental to a kid's shoulder or elbow, okay? How early should they start pitching? How early should they start throwing these breaking balls? So we'll talk a little bit about that. Pitch count has also been identified as something that puts a kid's elbow and shoulder at risk. And so there have been guidelines. USA Baseball has collaborated with James Andrews down in Alabama. Okay, they've looked at, God, I think it was 700 kids over a year. Okay, and they looked at the numbers. They looked at how many games they were playing, how many pitches they were throwing, what kind of injuries they suffered, and they've come up with guidelines. And I think they're overall generally accepted guidelines for according to what age they are, number of pitches, amount of rest between outings. And so I've got some data on that we'll look at. What age they should start. It's also controversial. And then, like I said, some limited studies on rest before and after events. I know, or we've been able to identify certain risk factors, okay? They've looked at large numbers of kids and try to identify things that put any particular kid at risk for developing a problem with their shoulder or elbow. And some of the things we've been able to identify is things we can't change, these non-modifiable risk factors, okay? We've noticed that the older you are, the more susceptible you are to a shoulder or elbow problem if you're a thrower, okay? Well, there could be a couple different reasons why that is, but it's true. Older kids throw harder, okay? They throw more, okay? Some might even say they complain less, okay? So you never know if they've got something that is a long-standing injury or just a lump, bump, or a bruise, okay? And so all we know is the older kids are more susceptible. Taller and heavier kids, okay, are also more susceptible. You've got that, 11-year-old pitcher who is, almost 6 feet, and, he weighs 170 pounds or what have you. Big kid, but he's at risk, okay? He's the equivalent of that older athlete, but his body is not as mature as that older athlete. So he's throwing harder, and he's doing more things like his older counterparts, but his body is not ready. So those kids are at risk. This is something interesting, decreased satisfaction. What does that mean? Well, you've got a lot of competition. It starts at an early age with these kids, okay? They want to start. They want to be the number one, But if they're not, their attitude is not as good, okay? They're not as excited to train, work out, prepare, okay? If they're not getting the nod, if you will, they really don't want to prepare, okay? And so that leads to injuries, increased injuries when they do go out and play because they're just not ready, okay? And so we've noticed that if kids are decreased or have less, or they're less satisfied in their accomplishments on the field, they're more susceptible to injury, okay? Those are things we can't change, okay? But some of the things that we can prevent are down on the bottom there. And so the first one there, warm-up pitches, okay? Warming up is great, but you can over-warm up if that is a term. Okay? If you think about warm-up pitches, they're just like game-time pitches, okay? The more you throw, the things that we just spent all that time talking about are more, or come up more, okay? It's all overuse. It doesn't have to just be game-time play. It can be practice, too. So you want to warm up, but you don't want to warm up too much. So we can certainly change that, right? Something I found interesting. 8 months or greater than 8 months of participation per year. I'm going to take a sort of a poll. Does anyone know any kids that play year-round? More than 8 months? 10? Yeah. I figured somebody would know somebody that... I mean, that's becoming more and more common, okay? But all that means is that kid's having a great time, but he is more, or she is more susceptible. Did you have a question?
No.
Oh, shoulder hurting?
No.
I'll give you my card.
You have a question.
Okay.
I get trained to softball back in the first
Uh-huh. In the back of your shoulder? Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Hmm. Yeah, we can, in the break, we'll talk about that a little bit more. But that might be something a little different than warm-up pitches, but we'll definitely talk about it. So, yeah, that's just more opportunity to injure yourself, okay? So over 80 pitches a game. So, again, over 8 months, you're 5 times more risk of injury through your shoulder or elbow, these kids, okay? Over 80 pitches a game. Now, there's different age groups, and we'll talk a little bit about that, but we know that number, that solid number, we know over that, we're getting in the danger zone, okay? We've identified that number as a number that we want to keep our kids no higher than that, because they're definitely putting themselves at risk, and we're putting them at risk if we're getting over that number, especially significant numbers over that. Over 85 miles an hour. Does anyone know a kid that pitches over 85 miles an hour? I didn't think so. We're pretty clear on that number. Not a whole lot of kids in this age group are going to be pitching 85 miles an hour. But at this age, if you do have a kid, they are at risk, okay? Velocity makes a difference. And then the last thing I put down there is pitching despite fatigue. They, you know, they come up for their start. They've had the adequate rest, but they're still having pain. If not pain, the arm feels weak, and they go out and participate. You know, they do their start. The shoulder's not right. And so if the shoulder's not right, and it goes back to the interval throwing program. If the shoulder is not right, you can't let them back out because they're more susceptible to injury. Yeah. That's a good number. I mean, there's really no absolute. You know, it's sort of a gray area.
We usually do around 20-25.
That's fine. You know, I think the better way to think about it is if you have the concrete numbers, so the kid's age, and you know how many, and we'll look at this a little bit, how many pitches they should be pitching. If you sort of add that pre-game number to their in-game number, you'll get around a number that they should be pitching, okay? You don't want to exceed that by too much because they're getting into danger zone. So 50, 60 warm-up pitches is definitely out of the question. They'll be done. They can't pitch in the game. So pre-game warm-ups are good, but keep them to a minimum. Sort of a weak answer, but best one I could give you. So here's the biomechanics piece, okay? So we've also identified the mechanics in the throw. We know, and this is just common sense, if a kid's mechanics are all over the place, you know, I love this one, you know. If your mechanics are all over the place, you're going to get hurt before your counterpart, your buddy that has perfect mechanics, okay? And that's just because you're putting other parts of your shoulder at risk when you're not coming over the top. And we'll talk a little bit. These are the five situations or aspects of the throwing process that we've identified as the most important, okay? Start at the top, leading with the hips, okay? We'll show a picture of that, okay? Leading with the hips is very important, okay? You're leading, so you're on the mound, And you're starting your motion, your forward hip is the first thing that goes toward the plate, and that's leading with the hips, okay? And so we'll show that. Hand on top of the ball, okay? We're not talking about, if anyone can see that, or everyone can see that. This here is my hand. Do you guys have a ball, baseball? hand underneath the ball is a position at risk, okay? That hand should be on top of the ball. And that puts the shoulder in a safe position, okay? So we'll look at that as well. Arm in the throwing position. Elbow at the, its highest point when the foot strikes. So we're talking about coming off the mound, foot striking. That elbow should be at its highest position, okay? I see a lot of this. And that is not, when that foot hits the ground, you don't want to be in this position. You want to be in this position. And then you come over. All right. So again, if you guys can see. So this is over the top. This is under the ball, okay? You want to be over the top. And again, the elbow, when you foot strike, your elbow is the highest thing. And then you come over. But we'll look at it. Closed shoulder position. The shoulder, so your leading shoulder is closest, and that's leading or pointing towards the plate. Again, when you hit, your shoulder is pointing towards the plate. Not out this way, not this way, but pointing at the plate. And that keeps your shoulder and elbow safe. And lastly, the stride foot is toward the plate. And so I see a lot of this as well. They come down and they're out here, okay? They're pointing to first base, or they're pointing to the dugout, okay? They're not coming toward the hitter or toward the plate. And so that coming toward the plate keeps you in the safe zone. And I'm sure I have some pitching coaches in here. Hopefully I do, so we can talk about that and I can get your thoughts on how you feel about it. But we've identified through research, through, you know, stop motion technology, correlating that with studies with the muscles and things, that those five aspects really need to be looked at and taught. And so this is the first one we talked about, leading with the hips. The guy in B on the right, his trunk, back trunk and hip are a straight line here, okay? This is what we want to avoid, all right? It's this guy on the left that's doing it correctly, all right? We've got an L or a point at the hip. And so the hip is leading, or the pelvis is leading the rest of the body toward the plate, okay? So that's the first point that I was trying to make. All right, what was the second point? Hand on top. Forearm pronated just means with your palm down. Again, late cocking phase, okay? You notice this is the palm up that I was trying to identify or show you guys, demonstrate. Palm down, again, you want that shoulder to be rotated in, okay? This way just puts the shoulder and the elbow in a stressful position. So you want to try to avoid that. So what happens when we finally come down with our foot? We want to make sure that elbow is at the highest point. Okay? We're foot striking or heel striking, as this guy shows, but it's not really on the heel, but this is what we want to try to avoid. The elbow is drop down this way. Again, if you guys just try it yourselves, it hurts to do that. It feels painful or it's stressful in the shoulder if your elbow is down. You want to keep your elbow up, internally rotated, if you will. That elbow should be at the highest point when you heel strike. So fourth one was, let's see, closed shoulder position. That shoulder should be pointing at the plate. Again, here's that open position that's bad for you, okay? I see a lot of this as well. How many coaches are in the audience here? Do you guys videotape your pitchers? Yeah, I strongly advocate if one of the parents has a video camera or when you guys are practicing, you know, take a look. Just for kicks, you know, take a look at what your pitchers are doing and think about these points, and I guarantee you, if not one, most of them have one of the five, if not more, in the improper position, okay? But again, you notice how this guy's shoulder, he's facing, or it's pointing right to home plate. He's in a safe position. And then lastly, that stride foot. It sort of shows in this picture here. The shoulder follows the foot, okay? And so if your foot is not coming down the line, your shoulder's not going to be. You're in this situation, which is, again, you're susceptible to injury. So we touched a little bit about pitch type. We know through research that over the age of about 13, 14, breaking pitches are a bit safer. Again, not a great idea in my opinion. But before the age of about 13, 14, I don't think any kid should throw a breaking pitch. I think it's just way too much stress on their elbow and their shoulder. You know, if they continue to do it, it's going to become a problem. And I've seen that before. And so if any parent ever asks me, I mean, what should I do? Coach wants him to throw a curveball and he's 11, 12 years old. I'm just not a big fan of it. Again, I'm going to run into someone that thinks something else, but that's just my opinion. Yeah, that's probably the best thing, you know. We really don't know for sure, but we know one thing we know for sure is before that age, that 13, 14 years of age, you're really doing a lot of damage because those bones are not built to snap that ball like that. So I just put down, if my kid wants to throw curveballs before the age of 14, I'm just going to say no. Sorry about this. I don't know if you guys can see it. If you give me your emails, I can send this to you. This is the data or the throwing interval throwing program of USA Baseball. Okay, like I said, they've come up with that through research with Jim Andrews Clinic down in Alabama. If you can't read that, I'll try to read it for you. So it goes by age group, okay, and it starts around age 9. I would say if you have kids younger than that, you should just fit them into that category. I've seen some 7, 8-year-olds, so I would just fit it into that category. So this is USA's baseball recommendation for pitch count, okay? Age 9 and 10, 50 per game. Should be no more than 50 pitches per game or 75 per week. All right. 1,000 per season. Now, how long is a season? Typically, coaches, how long is a season? Oh, okay. So is that a hard question to answer? Okay. Well, in any one season shouldn't be over that. Sounds like a lot, but that's a lot of, it's not. Okay. And then 2,000 per year. Okay. So if you're playing 10 months a year, that's not a whole lot of pitches. Okay. Now we move up to the 11, 12-year-olds. We just up that a little bit. So it's 75 per game, 100 per week, 1,000 per season, 3,000 a year. Up again to the 13, 14-year-olds. Not that much change between the 12-year-olds, just a little bit more per week. So it's 75 per game, 125 per week, 1,000 per season, 3,000 a year. And so beyond that, you're getting, you amp that up a little bit and you're getting more towards the adults. Yeah. That's coming next. Rest between outings. Okay. So we'll go back to this says 8 to 10-year-olds. Okay. 1 day of rest between throwing. If you're pitching no more than about 20, 20 pitches. One day of rest in between is okay. If you're up in your pitches to about 35, you need at least 2 days of rest in between. 45 pitches, about 3 days. And then if you're hitting that max, that 50, you need at least 4 days of rest in between outings. Does that answer your question? So it goes up that way. 10, 11-year-olds, one day if you're no more than, or well, if you're 27 to 40 pitches, 2 days, 35 to 50, 3 days, 55 to 70. Certainly when you're hitting 11, 12-year-olds was here. If you're hitting the 75, then you want at least 4 days. Again, it just follows suit here, and I can email any one of you guys this information, all right? And you probably already have this. 13 to 14-year-olds, 30 to 50 pitches one day, 35 to 60 pitches 2 days, 55 to 75, three, and 75 to 94. And then we're getting up to the 15, 16 to 17, 18-year-olds. Again, if you're 15, 16, and you're throwing 75 to 90 pitches a game, 4 days. Again, 17 to 18, you're getting in that 100 pitch range, 4 days. So again, I can get you guys any of that information. So we took a while talking about shoulders and elbows. I'll touch on a couple little more things. Do you want a break? Anyone hungry? Thirsty? Probably, right? I'm thirsty. So a couple more things and we'll stop. Wrist and finger injuries. Again, common in baseball. I see it all the time. Sliding into a base that is, you know, I don't even know what you would call it.
Anchored
base. That becomes a problem. Do you guys use anchored bases? You do. What age does that start? When I was growing up, we didn't have anchored bases. You kick second base into left field. Really? Okay. Well, they're immovable, and so the bone is what loses in that situation. So I showed you that X-ray at the very beginning, top of the talk. Those inherently weak parts of the bone can fracture from one of these. We'll look at a couple things. I see this a lot in hitters, okay? And sometimes you take a ball off the heel of the glove, you can get what's called a hamate fracture, okay? There are 8 bones in the wrist. Yeah, 8. And they're small, but this one protrudes out the most, and you can actually feel it. If you grab your palm on the pinky side, just past the wrist, and you push down really hard, you can feel a bone right there. Okay? Does everyone see that? The other thing you can do is follow your lifeline down, and at the end of that lifeline, you can feel a tough sort of bone that's poking out there. That's called a hamate, and it pokes out, so it's the most susceptible. So if you can imagine, you're hitting, and you hit just off center off the bat, and you get that vibration. That force is generated right to the palm and to that bone because it's most susceptible, can crack. Again, there it is right there. If it breaks, what happens is every time you hit, you have pain. Okay, fielding a ball as well, if it's on the glove hand, will cause pain. Needs surgery, because it can cause irritation. There are nerves in that area, especially the ulnar nerve, your funny bone nerve. You know, when you hit your elbow, you feel tinglingness in your pinky finger, okay? That nerve is in your palm, too. And so if that bone is loose, it can cause pinching of that nerve, and that's what you'll get in your hand. We have to remove those. It's pretty easy surgery. It's pretty straightforward. You're back to playing in around 3 to 4 weeks after that. But needs to be diagnosed earlier than later. A mallet finger, I see this a lot as well. The fielder goes to field a ground ball. Their top hand comes down a bit too early, and that ball
jams their finger, and then they can't straighten it. Okay, that's because the tendon that helps you straighten your finger gets torn off the bone. Okay, and so that usually doesn't need surgery, but again, the longer you wait, the worse of a problem it is. Broken bones, fractures, that is. Again, same situation. If the tendon doesn't tear, you can get a broken finger. Okay, jam on a base or jammed by the ball. Jersey finger, not as common in baseball, but again, it's the opposite of the mallet finger, where the tendon on the palm side gets torn. That's a little bit more troublesome, okay? And so we really have to identify those characters because that almost always needs surgery, all right? So finger problems, they're really common, but some of them need special attention, so it's good to be aware. So I was going to stop it there. Does that sound good? Catastrophic injuries, what are we talking about? Well, these are really the silent killers, okay, with our young athletes. And so it's really important to be knowledgeable and be aware of some of the things that can happen. Now, pre-participation physicals have made a huge difference in us recognizing these things. As I said, this is a silent thing. People have no symptoms whatsoever until it's too late. And so we're able to now, with the pre-participation exams, identify folks that might be at risk for something like up top here. Does anyone know who these people are? No, this is actually Reggie Lewis up top. Len Bias played for the same team, or barely, back in the 80s. And then that's Hank Gathers in the bottom. They both died of the same thing. Now, those aren't kids, okay? And those guys played sports all their lives. Probably had some symptoms, but ignored them, okay? Up until it was too late, okay? These two guys, they collapsed from heart failure during a game, okay? And so, again, this hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is a silent killer, okay? And we don't know who has it, but we can identify those that may with the pre-participation physical. So very important to make sure all your kids are passing their physicals before they start to participate. Head and neck injuries, very uncommon in baseball, more common in your collision contact, more contact like soccer, football, even basketball. Essentially, it's a temporary injury to the nerves in the neck and arms, okay? You know, you could have a kid sliding head first into second base and get their head tweaked to the side. What that does is it stretches the neck and the nerves attached to the neck and the spinal cord, okay? That'll give them a temporary dead arm. The arm completely goes dead. Or they get tingling and numbness in their arm. It's usually transient, meaning it gets better in several seconds to minutes. It doesn't usually last longer than several minutes, but can have some lingering effects thereafter. Again, important to realize and get that kid help as soon as you can. Concussions, really hot topic. Again, baseball, you don't see a whole lot of concussions. You see them at the professional level sometimes, but I'm not seeing a whole lot of concussions in the teenage baseball player. Can't happen. Again, collisions at the plate, balls or heads being struck by balls, bats, that sort of stuff. What is it? Well, it's a rapid acceleration of the brain within the vault of the skull. Okay, your brain lives in your skull, and that skull is pretty hard, okay? But quick, rapid rotation of the head, okay, if your head gets knocked one direction or the other quick enough, the brain can't keep up with the spinning of the head, and it bumps into the sides of the skull, causing what we call a concussion or a mild traumatic brain injury, Okay? Very important to realize, recognize, and treat as early as possible. 1.6 to 3.8 million of these a year. Okay? So they're very common. By definition, we're talking about a constellation of symptoms. So what does the child have? They have physical, cognitive, emotional, and sleep-related symptoms. What does all that mean? Well, physical, headache, blurred vision, okay? And this is not even at the time of the concussion. These are post-concussive symptoms that they may have. They go back to school. They can't concentrate, okay? They can't remember. They have short-term memory loss. These are some of the cognitive things. Emotional. They'll be, you know, you tell them to go clean their room, they break down crying. Unusual emotional response to a typical situation can be a clue to post-concussive state, sleep-related. Either sleeping too much or too little, okay? And the duration of the symptoms can be variable, okay? Some kids, you know, they can suffer a concussion and be completely fine half an hour later. Anyone know who Sidney Crosby is? Okay. He was out for, what, over a year with a concussion. So it's variable, okay? So that's one of the questions I get frequently is, when can my kid return to play? And we'll get to that. So at home, you're looking for difficulty completing tasks, cleaning their room, doing their homework, reduced play or activity. They don't want to play. They don't want to be in a bright room, okay? They want to be off on their own by themselves, okay? Not a whole lot of stimulation. You ask them to do their homework, and they have a whole lot of problem, and they get irritable with that. I mean, they don't want to do it, and they're just overreacting. Might be a small clue. At school, difficult. They might have difficulty concentrating anyway, but increased difficulty concentrating at school, remembering directions, they're disorganized, tired, they fall behind in their classwork. These are some of the clues and some of the neurophysiological effects. Again, the attention, concentration, their working memory is lagging behind, their speed of processing information. You give them a telephone number and 5 seconds later they can't remember it. And their reaction time. We look at all these things. So how long does it take an athlete to recover from a concussion? This is where the child versus adult fits in. So I've got a busy slide here, but the take home is we sort of looked at these things at different age groups. And we looked at the time to recovery, okay? So in the top here, we've got college age athletes. All right, suffering concussions. On average, they recover in about 7 days, but 91% of them were done, recovered, ready back to go back to play in around 7 days, okay? Now we've sort of dropped the age level to high school. We notice that less kids are recovering in that same time frame. So what is it that's the problem there? Well, the problem is kids at the teenage level, the brain is still, again, immature, okay? That means all the connections in the brain are immature. What is the brain made up of? Well, it's made up of circuits, okay? And those circuits have not matured yet. And so when they're injured, they take even longer to repair themselves. So we can't treat adult concussions, like you see, you know, a guy in the NFL, he's back in a week after a concussion. You know, a kid with the same trauma, it may take a month to get back. And so it's important to recognize that kid concussions are more severe than their adult counterparts. And so that's what that slide says. So basically, treatment is rest, 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 and then when you've rested, you rest some more, okay? And that means rest, just not just physical rest, emotional rest, cognitive rest, okay? Sleep. I know there's an old sort of, I don't want to say wives' tale, but when a kid has an injury, you're worried about them going to bed and going to sleep and not waking up. Well, in very extreme situations, that is a concern. When you're talking about concussions, you want to make sure they get their rest, okay? Early on, you may want to wake them up on intervals, and if they're not waking up when they should wake up, okay, that's an indication of something more serious going on. That is, if you go to arouse them and they're not normally arousable, that's a little different situation. But we've got the concussion. We're a couple days out now. We want to make sure you're resting so you can recover. Limit the activity. You don't want to increase their heart rate. Again, if you increase their heart rate, you're increasing their activity of their brain, and that's going to prolong things. So it's just broader than sports, okay? We're talking about children here. So sport, but academic and daily activities. Those are things that we have to think about when they're recovering. So you want to manage these things. Manage their activities, their physical and their cognitive activities. We talked about that. But when it comes to school, no long hours at school initially, okay? Kids are going to love this. No homework, okay? No extracurricular activities. They're coming straight home, resting, and as little concentration on things as possible. And so that's what I'm talking about here. You want to have absolute rest. Again, we just said that. So, criteria for return to play. When can they get back out on the field? Well, they have to absolutely have no symptoms of a concussion. Some of the things that we talked about earlier. They have to be absolutely normal, okay? And nowadays what we do is we put them through tests, okay? We do put them through neurophysiological tests and ocular tests and hearing tests. Well, that's not necessarily true. It's the connections between the certain parts of the brain that we test. And if they react normally, they're ready to go back to play. And then they have to be cleared by a medical professional. How to return them back to play? Again, you start them slow, just like a throwing program, okay? They initially have the no activity, and then you start stressing them. Light aerobic activity, okay? And then if they've passed that level, you start getting them into their sport-specific activities, okay? Starting to run the bases, throwing, hitting. For sports that involve contact, non-contact drills, and then go on to full contact drills. And if they've passed all those things, they're ready to get back out there. And so all in all, we know that the immature brain acts differently than the adult, so we have to be aware of that. And they shouldn't go back until they are symptom-free. They have a headache, they're still symptomatic from a concussion. It's not time to return to play. So what we need to do is we individualize the treatment for all these athletes. No one concussion is different than another. They're sort of like snowflakes. Everyone is different. So we have to treat them differently. And we have to treat them all as individuals. We just have to make sure our schools have the proper personnel on the sidelines, in the dugout, part of the medical evaluation staff that know what they're doing, they're aware of this and can diagnose it and know the avenues to take. So what's the worst thing that can happen? If my son or daughter goes back before they're ready, it's something called second impact syndrome, where the brain is more susceptible to injury if it hasn't fully recovered from the initial injury, okay? And you hear these stories on ESPN, Outside the Lines and so forth, of these children tragically dying from head injuries. And that's what we're talking about, okay? They may have suffered a concussion in sport, didn't tell anyone about it, kept it quiet because they wanted to play, still had symptoms, went back to play, and had a second concussion, which is cumulative, okay? And so it can lead to death. So we really need to be aware of this, and we're learning more and more about this all the time. So we're really getting good at diagnosing these. Now, multiple concussions. Sometimes I have kids come to me, they're pre-participation physicals. They're like, You know, I asked them how many concussions they had. I've had about 5. I think over 3, and you should probably encourage that child to do something else, okay? Because we're getting sort of like the overuse things we've been talking about. Multiple concussions become cumulative, okay? They add upon one another. And so, do you have a question? Does it hurt worse if you get a second concussion after an initial concussion? Not necessarily. It could be milder, okay? And honestly, I've had, I don't even know how many concussions I've had when I played football all my life. And I've probably, we didn't really know of concussions when I was a kid. I mean, we knew of them, but we weren't diagnosing them as well as we are now. So we used to say, oh man, I just got my clock cleaned or my bell rung, okay? That was a concussion, okay? But we would crack these little ammonia capsules and sniff them, get back out on the field, okay? Now we know, I see some of you guys smiling because you've heard of this before, now we know that is not the proper way to deal with it. We know this now, but you know, years ago, we didn't recognize it. We're getting smarter now. So, and I think our athletes are benefiting from our increased knowledge, okay? So I think that's it, yeah. Key to prevention is education. So make sure your coaches, parents, athletic trainers, and most importantly, you kids, you guys need to be honest. If you have any of these injuries that we talked about today, you have to be forthcoming with the information. What does that mean? You got to tell your mom, dad, you got to tell your coach or your trainer, the assistant on the team, whoever is older than you, that's important. You need to tell them if you're hurting, because that's how we figure all these things out and we can get you back playing without any pain and having fun. And that's most important. That's it. I'm finally done. Thanks for coming, guys. I really appreciate you having me. I hope you learned something.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, no problem.
Next week, we'll wrap it up.